There's leftover food downstairs, meatballs, no mashed potatoes and gravy. They must have been the big hit, huh? Gravy, coleslaw, I don't know. Is there beans and carrots and all the rest? Whatever you'd like. You have to wait till the end of this program, though. When the program this afternoon is finished, we'll all go downstairs and have cake and refreshments. You notice they didn't say coffee. You can have that, but that's there's other better stuff to drink, too. So that's after the service this afternoon. And then before you leave, stop by the kitchen, and if you want something to take home, why, you're welcome to do that. Just one other announcement. Did everyone get a bulletin either this morning or this afternoon? In the bulletin is the order of service for this afternoon, as well as there's an insert. I'm not going to read the weekly schedule, but on the opposite side, we want to invite you all back here for two special events in the next couple of months. On Friday night, August 23rd, 7 o'clock, we're very happy to have Chuck Crane from Branson, Missouri here. He used to sing with the Blackwood Brothers Quartet and now sings at Presley's Country Jubilee with the Southern Gospel Quartet. He and his wife will be here, have a concert Friday night, August 23rd. We invite you all to come. And then on Sunday night, September 22nd, at 7 o'clock, we're very happy to have with us Usama Dakdok. He has been here before. You hear him on VCY Radio, Monday through Fridays at 12:30 p.m. He was raised in Egypt and received his training, post-high school training here in the United States, and shares around the country concerning how to witness to Muslims and the seriousness of the Islamic problem today. But his focus is on being a witness for Christ to our Muslim neighbors. And you're welcome to come. 7 o'clock, September 22nd, Saturday night. I think that's about all the announcements we have. Anything else should be announced? Okay. Let's turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day of Jubilee, a day of singing praises to your name. God, you have been so good to us. We thank you for these years of blessing and for the promise of your faithfulness. And Lord, we look forward to that as long as you leave us here on earth, that we might glorify your name. So we pray this afternoon that you will be exalted in our hearts and minds and our lives, and we praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, after that meal, it's time for you to stand, and we're going to sing number 3, Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Oh, my soul, praise and glory is thine.
Our turn to read scripture together. Let's turn in the back of your hymnals, number 582. It's called Worship. It's a responsive reading from Psalm 89. And I will read the beginning verse in the light print, and we ask you to respond with the bold print following. Number 582. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever with my mouth. With thy mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all them that are above him.
O Lord God of hosts, who is strong, Lord, like unto thee, or to thy faithfulness from about thee.
Thou rulest the raging of the sea when the waves thereof arise, and thou stillest them.
The heavens are thine.
Thou hast a mighty arm, strong is thy hand, and high is thy right hand.
Blessed is the people that know the joyful sound. They shall walk, O Lord, in the light of thy countenance.
In thy name shall they rejoice all the day, and in thy righteousness shall they be exalted.
For thou art the glory of their strength.
Amen. You may be seated. We ask the quartet to come up.
Thank you. God gives me a song I can sing. Keep silent, ye mountains, ye fields and ye fountains, for this is the time I must sing. It's the time to sing praises to the rock of the ages, and this is the time I must sing.
Jesus is calling, calling, his
just before we call on the West Prairie Singers, we did receive one testimony by mail this week, and I'd like to just share it with you. Dear friends, my name is Freeman Walters. I was born into your congregation on September 24th, 1927, the son of Lewis and Anna Walters. While growing up, along with my sister Lucille and brother Vernon, we attended church each Sunday. I can still picture the people entering the church, sitting down quietly in the pews with eyes closed in prayer as they drew near into worship. The church was the heart of the community. Reverend Nessheim always took the time to ask each one, "Do you know Jesus as your Savior and Lord?" Sunday school was first. There I learned the love and joy of following Christ. The song, "Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, for the Bible Tells Me So." Later, I was confirmed, and my roots were put down deep because of the faithful teachers and pastors who shared with me and taught me the good news about Jesus, who came and died on the cross to save me. Reverend Nessheim married my wife Hazel and I at the parsonage in March and of 1945. Our first son, Larry Everett, died shortly after being born that year and is buried on the hillside there by my parents and brother. In 1950s and 60s, my brother Vernon and I owned the Purdy School. Our kids attended Sunday school there when vacationing. They fondly remember the steps in the hillside as we climbed them to go into worship, just as my family and I had many years before that. My mother Annie cleaned the church for many years. She would pack a lunch basket and walk the mile to church, spending the day cleaning and communing with God. She saw many of her prayers answered. Some answers came long after her passing. This I recall to mind, and therefore I have hope. The Lord's loving kindnesses never cease. His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. God has continued to bless me and use me throughout my life. At age 91, I am still able to take part in ministry in my home church in Leon, teaching adult Sunday school, with the Gideons International doing Bible handouts, and in jail ministry at Monroe County Justice Center. I am proud to be a friend of the Bad Axe Independent Lutheran Church. I want to say thank you for your many years of holding the banner of Jesus high in your community, and never failing to tell others the good news of the gospel, that Jesus saves. Congratulations on your 150th anniversary. May God continue to bless and use you in his service for many years to come. In Christian Fellowship, Freeman Walters. We don't have time for a lot more sharing today. You can share with one another downstairs after the service. Now we'll call on the West Prairie Singers.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here and to take part in this. And we have learned the truth of this song. It was originally written for a 100th anniversary celebration for another church, so we figured it was quite appropriate for today. And if you look through the Psalms, you will find several references to being God as a rock. But now we're asking you to join us in singing Victory in Jesus. It's hymn number 526. No, 526 for them. I copied it from a different book for these guys. But we want you to sing with us. We know that you know parts, and so I expect this to be a real heavenly choir, Victory in Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you. Isn't it great to have a nice singspiration like today? Sing those great songs of salvation and joy in the Lord. So happy to have you all here this afternoon to celebrate the greatness of what God has done for 150 years. And we just thank the Lord for the ministry of this congregation over those years and continuing on. This is not kind of a death knell of the end of 150 years. This is the first day of tomorrow, right? It's yet to come. Till the Lord comes again, takes us home to glory. He's got something for us to do here yet. And so we're thankful that we can together rejoice in the message of the gospel to share with far and near. So thank you each for coming. Let's have a word of prayer. We're going to commit this offering to the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you today for the joy of salvation, the message in these songs of praise. Thank you, Lord, for your good work in each life who opens their hearts to you. And we pray that we might be light and testimony for you until Jesus comes again. So take these gifts and use them to the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Ask the ushers. Today, and thank the Lord for his many years of ministry in this congregation as well. Before we call on him to bring the word, Let's turn to number 54 in our hymnals. A song written on the theme verses for this weekend. Great is thy faithfulness. 54.
Thankful for the way I was introduced. Then we will call on Pastor Quam to share the word. Because I really want this to be more than a series of memories that somehow or other we can't live on. Memories are good, but memories don't bring us to heaven. And I want to land on something that is better than memories. So thank you for that intro. Couldn't have been more appropriate. Lamentations chapter 3, 21. This I call to mind, therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies, or some translations say his loving kindness, never cease. They're new every morning. Yes, great is your faithfulness. Pray. Heavenly Father, you who are the same yesterday, today, and forever, thank you that you were the same God 150 years ago as you are today and as you will be at the 175th anniversary. And whether we celebrate that here or in heaven, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that in knowing him, we can have the joy in this life and confidence for the next and his presence forever. And now as we remember, we pray that we remember rightly for your glory, for your kingdom's furtherance, and yes, for our joy as well. And now I'm praying that the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth would be acceptable to you, because that's what really matters. Amen. And so on the 150th anniversary, I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus, the name that doesn't change. We read that in the Word of God, of course, Hebrews 13:9. And as I mentioned in my prayer, you know, it is so good to know that in 1869, the God who was the leader and the impetus of the founding of Bad Axe Church, well, it's the same in 2019. I just praise God for that. And he's been faithful all through these years, and faithful in the time that we served here some decade and a half ago and back a ways. Before I get into the message as such, I would just want to share also that there's 15 other people that would kind of like to have been here today, our children and their spouses and our grandchildren, some of whom you know. But you know, the generations go on, and now they have their own families and their own sphere of activities. And so instead of being here, they just asked their old man to share the greeting. So greetings from all of them. Greetings from all of them. So God has been faithful. I'm so thankful that I do know a little bit of the history of Bad Axe. And I'm so thankful that integral in the history of Bad Axe are a couple of times of distinct revival. When the message of Jesus was not only presented, but it was received, and people came to Christ. And it became the anchor of this fellowship, and I believe you can be so thankful for that. And in all these years since that time, our God has been faithful. I didn't say that everything that you planned has unfolded exactly as you thought, because it hasn't. But God's been faithful in the good times, and God's been faithful when there was no place left to go but God. Those are wonderful times too. I think it was A.W. Tozer who said, "Never despise those things which drive you to your knees." And you know, Bad Axe has had those years too. And so have you. And through these changes and through the experiences of life, the loving kindness of God, well, that's the constant. And we're so thankful for that. It was my particular joy to work with Bad Axe in a time when you made a tremendous and momentous decision, but a decision that was not easy by any means. And it was a joy to be able to sit across from some tears and some times of a little bit of disconcerting times. And as you made that decision, some years back now, already about a quarter of a century, it was a joy to just minister of the one anchor, the Lord Jesus Christ. And God has blessed you, and I'm just so thankful for that. Through it all, God is faithful. This is kind of a celebration service, and so with your permission, I'm going to share a few memories. Now, I'm not going to share a whole raft of them. A whole raft of them is what I have. But I'm not going to. As I said, memories don't get you to heaven. But they are encouraging sometimes, and they're fun. And I don't think God has as his high desire that we don't have any fun and enjoyable times. But I do remember some things, which I will just share ever so briefly. I remember in beginning to serve down here in 1984, dropping down the hill. I've told my wife so many times, she's just flat sick of hearing it. Sorry once more. And how beautiful it was every time I dropped down the hill from the highway out there and just came down. Sometimes I'd drive into the fog, and sometimes I'd drive out of the fog, depending on the weather conditions. But we have a wonderful Creator. Even that, super good. And then I remember the realization when it hit me that everybody in Bad Axe is related to somebody. I mean, that's the way it is. Pastor Grevin, you may have made some changes in that, but I'll tell you. Well, it made me really careful, but that's the way it was, and it's just an amazing biological net, not just the way it is. But I remember also laying to rest some of the old people, really old. I remember laying to rest the really young. They'd never had a chance to explore life. And somehow or other, in the providence of God, He took them to Himself. Those are times that connect your blood forever. And I'm one of the few that the thinning bunch that remembers the original Bad Axe Quartet. I happen to know all of them. Never too well any of them, but I knew all of them. Stump and Lester and Leroy, Aleph, and heard them sing. They're probably still singing, but we don't hear them well now. And just kind of one of those things. Many of you remember them too, but fewer and fewer. I also remember one time, as I remember this, somebody came to me and said, you know what I remember about your ministry at Bad Axe? Well, proud guy that I am. I thought, he's going to feed me back some profound bit of spiritual wisdom, or at least practical. I said, well, no, I really don't. And I was kind of doing this. And he... He said, yeah, what I remember about you is driving down there on your motorcycle and with a suit on and your tie streaming back behind you as you came down the hill. And I thought, well, so much for wisdom. But I'm humbled at seeing the way that God has honored His promise. Isn't that something? The way God honors His promise? I'm just thankful that I was privileged to share God's word. You know, I'm going to demise. Looking at my hair, some of you think I should have already. But God's word won't. You know, the Word of God is, it's settled in the heavens. The Word of God is the same. The Word of God is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. And the Word of God runs under its own promise that it will accomplish that for which He sent it. And He will empower it by His Holy Spirit to draw people to Himself and land their faith on the finished work of Jesus, which ultimately in eternity lands them in heaven. And that's the good part. That's the good part. God is always faithful. And I'm so thankful that in spite of all my bothersome and irritating idiosyncrasies in the presentation of the word or ministry or life, that God's word still runs under its own promise. Isn't that good? God knows that. And you know, the more deficient we are as people, probably the more rejoicing we are in recognizing that that promise is forever true. And but you know, there's something else before I get into the message, and that is that after ministering here for about 2 decades and getting to know you and love you as a people, being here basically on loan for a couple of decades, you learn to like people. I said like, yeah. I love you because God told me to, but I like you also. You know, there's something about being melded into a family that you want the best for your kids. And I'm so thankful that God has so orchestrated in the ongoing history of this church in the decade and a half since we have not ministered here actively, that God has brought you a man who preaches the gospel so that I can come back and I can see my kids and I can see them growing in grace and I can see God's family expanding and I can see the maturing of God's people. That's so great. And we still pray for you. We pray for your pastor. And just as a one who has been gifted with a pastor's heart, I don't have it by nature, but that's so good, the way God has worked. And so we come to anniversaries. Anniversaries remind me of a story, well, it's a record, really, not just a story, of Moses, when before his death, God led him up to Mount Nebo. He was led up to Mount Nebo so that he could see the promised land, because in the course of his life, he had erred and sinned against God, and God had told him, you are not going to go into the promised land. But he said, I will bring you up, and in my grace, I'm going to show you the promised land, even though you're not going there, because I said you weren't. You were not faithful in following me when on one particular thing when you demeaned my name. So as Moses was going up Mount Nebo, now this is a picture in my head, speculation, but anniversaries remind me of this. So as Moses is going up Mount Nebo, I have a feeling that Moses, from time to time, turned around and looked down at that Israelite camp. That camp that he had been leading for 40 years. That camp that God had disciplined and God had directed and God had protected and provided and kept them all those years. He'd look back at them. And then as he crested the hill, crested Mount Nebo, and he could, as his eyes and his vision cleared out and he could see the promised land on the other side, he could see what was going to come. And then he'd turn back and he'd look there and he could see the past and he could look up there and he could see the future that he would never be an active part of. And I feel at that very moment, Moses could have said the exact words that were penned centuries later by a prophet who came right into the Israel's history at probably its worst time. He could have said, great is your compassion. They don't fail. They're new every morning. And as he looked back, great is your faithfulness. As Egypt quick played through his mind and the wilderness quick played through his mind and as Mount Sinai quick played through his mind and then as he looked over and there it is, my people's future. That's kind of the way an anniversary is. We've been looking a bunch at the past. We really have. And I enjoy it. I could spend a lot of time on memories. You know that I'm kind of a sentimental old codger, and I kind of like that. But as I said, that's not where you live. So we'll look ahead a little bit. But in between the behind and the ahead is that little hinge point we call the present. And that's an important moment, because that's where you're at right today, the present. You'll never be able to go back into the past. And in all candor, you never really quite hit the future. You just keep going toward it. So I want to talk about the present a little bit. I think all of you could understand it, and you would say a hearty amen. God is faithful in the history of bad acts. But how about this moment? I'm thankful for the emphasis of the message this morning. And I wasn't in concert with Pastor Grevin or anything about this, but I just feel like we couldn't look at the faithfulness of God in the past without addressing for a moment the wonder of God in the present, this time in eternity, from your birth to your home going, packed into this time is the time when you determine where you will spend the long side of eternity. And if there were ever a thing where God is faithful, that's it right there. Because as God created Adam and Eve and placed them in the Garden of Eden, and then they spurned him thumbed their nose at him in sin and unbelief and separated themselves from the close communion of God. And then God reaches out to them again in his love and in his faithfulness and in his ongoing loving kindness. And at the expense of his son's life, he bought us back. Now that is faithfulness. That is love that is not ceasing. That is love that just is beyond human comprehension. The character of God's love for his creation. And even as the same person who wrote our text this morning said in Jeremiah 31, he said, I have loved them with an everlasting love, talking about his people. He could look right over this congregation right now and say, I have loved every one of you with an everlasting love, and so I've drawn you to myself. And then it was so good to hear those young people quote those verses, which are the anchor for eternity. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is a matter of the faithfulness of God, calling back to himself a fallen human race, calling back at the expense of his Son, calling back in spite of all that we are, all that we aren't, and laying before us the wonderful gift of finished salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. That is faithfulness of God. Setting before us that joyous adoption back into the family of God. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for you. And to go into the future without that aspect of understanding and reception of the love of God in Christ, the future is so empty. So empty. But with the assurance that sinners can have who come to Jesus, we can have hope for the future. And coming to Jesus, we have that solid assurance once again. He won't cast us out. He doesn't run some pedigree by his records or his acceptance or anything like that. He just runs Jesus by. And if we can receive the Lord Jesus through repentance and faith, we have a home in heaven with him forever. That is saving faithfulness of God. And that faithfulness has been proclaimed here. Been proclaimed here so that in the days to come, there's really not a soul that's going to be able to say, I never heard about that. If there's anybody here that ever spends a Christless eternity in hell, it's not going to be because God is unfaithful, and it's not going to be because the message hasn't been proclaimed. It's going to be because we have willfully stood against the invite of the Holy God. And I would just echo what was said this morning. If there's a soul here that today is not resting in that finished work, oh, the invitation of God is so broad and so long and so powerful and so anchored that it still invites you to come to Jesus, be saved. And we have the thankfulness that God will never go back on his promise. So that's my heart for you, for the present. And we read in the scriptures that God is merciful and slow to anger and great in his, there's that word again, loving kindness to draw us to himself. He is a faithful God. We echo that relatively new song, Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. And that's the live that is not only here in this 70, but it is the live that is extended to all of eternity in the presence of God. Live for Jesus. That's what matters. And that will be true peace and true celebration. Celebrating God's faithfulness. And I want to commend you on your theme for this weekend. I think it's a great theme. I just love it. But I also want to caution you against one other thing. And that is I want to caution you not to pull those two or three verses out of the Book of Lamentations and just hang yourself on that nice theme. And so I want to bring you the context to you and pull in the surround of it. Jeremiah wrote, well, this was written about probably 580 years before Christ, thereabouts. And we don't have that burned in our mind. But for them, it was kind of like our 9/11 or Pearl Harbor or something like that. That date for them was the epitome of awfulness when they got overrun. And it is almost as if Jeremiah was preaching a type of funeral for them. It was a tough time. This was the awfulest time in the history of Israel. And you got an assignment this morning to read the book of Acts in your spare time this evening. Well, because that won't quite fill out your spare time, I'm going to give you an assignment. Read also the book of Lamentations. And you're going to find out that right in the center of Lamentations is the text which we read today about the faithfulness of God and about the fact that it's new every morning. But I want to tell you something. If you go to the verses on both sides of that, before it and afterwards, you are going to see awfulness. Why is the book called Lamentations? Because it's a lament. It's five sections of a lament. And right in the middle we have this. But, this I call to mind right in the middle of all of this awfulness. And because of that I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, and its mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. So why do I bring in the context? Here's the reason. I think most of you that have read the Bible and have listened to preaching here and other places, you are aware that, well, the days we live in aren't the best in many ways. In fact, if we were to put it in a biblical sense, we would say that the days in which we live are quickly and obviously leading up to the end of days and the return of the Lord Jesus. I'm not going to proclaim how all that is going to unfold and how it's all going to play. What I am going to say is that we are a whole lot closer and more immediate to it than we've ever been before. It's just that way. And so I'm not saying that bad acts has bad days in front of them. No, not at all. Let me get this straight before you. Because that is coming, and I believe it is, then the best days of bad acts are probably still in front of you. Because into the darkness of the end time stuff that Paul talks about over in many places, 2 Timothy, in the last days perilous times shall come, Men shall be lovers of themselves. And you can read that on, that's the third part of your assignment. Read 2 Timothy 2. It's there. Matthew 24 tells about it. I want you to look at that. That's what's coming. That's the time into which bad acts and God's people will move and are moving right now. And so we are called upon to, just like this little diamond in this bushel basket of coal, bad acts is called to be a diamond, a lighthouse in the valley, if you will, of the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ, where people can hear the gospel, the good news that in the midst of all of this awfulness, there's a Savior who is waiting to receive you at the end of life and at the end of all of his awfulness, so to speak, and receive you to himself. And even now he's preparing a place for you. You have the opportunity of being that reflector. What an awesome opportunity that is. Oh, yes, times are bad, and we could be pessimistic to the nth degree on that. But I want to tell you, I have every reason to believe that Christians are looking at the most influential days that Christendom has ever known. When does a light shine brightest? Well, of course, it shines the same. But when do you notice it? You notice it when it's dark out. I could be shining up a million candle power thing right here, and you'd squint a little bit, but it's pretty bright out. But if I did that in the middle of the night, you'd say, wow, that's a bright light. And that's exactly the place that you are at as a fellowship right now. You are at that place where you are just set to shine for the days of the Lord, for the Lord Jesus Christ and the days before he returns. That's a joy. I feel like I'm kind of an inveterate optimist. So when I say that, I'm not saying that things will be easy. What I'm saying that it will be days of grand opportunity to reflect the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, that's the way it is. That's the way it is. As we go on pondering, it is good to remember. It's good to remember. So I hope you have that affirmed confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. I hope you're rejoicing in the past. It's good. I'm not going to ask for a vote, because I think you'd vote me down, but... I think it'd be kind of fun to go about an hour and a half and tell stories, but that wouldn't do any good. It just embarrassed me, I suppose, or you. But it is so good to remember, isn't it? I just love it when you come up to me and say, you know what I remember? Even if it's so crazy as that, what you remember about me with my streaming tie behind my back going down the road with my motorcycle. To have the confidence in Jesus. That's good. That's good. And so you move into this time of the very specific high call of God to be a witness for him in times when it may not be easy, but times when it will be intensely rewarding for the kingdom of God and can move it ahead. But it doesn't happen without a relationship. This verse that we have shared is so important because it says his mercies are new every morning. And you know what? That's how often you need to appropriate the grace of God. To set yourself once again in the sure footing of the Lord Jesus Christ and his word. So that if you, as you stand in the world with the world about you, you are anchored in what will last forever, the Lord Jesus Christ. I like that. They are new every morning. It is not as if somehow or other we receive a shot for life when we repent of our sin and trust the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. It is not as if when our names are changed from the devil's register in hell to the Lamb's Book of Life, that somehow or other God infuses to us a forever burst of energy. His mercies are new every morning, just as the manna was new every day to the people who, as they were waiting it out in the wilderness. I challenge you to let this Word of God be your anchor. To let that which does not change be your directive and strength of soul forever. The mercies of God are new every morning. And in those mercies of God, once again, your eyes will be open to see the field before you, to see the way that you may shine in the darkness as a glory to God, and fulfill Matthew 5:16, where it says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works," yes, "but glorify your Father who is in heaven." That's it. So, I'm here to tell you, I think the best days for you are ahead. If you think the reminiscing of the past 150 has been kind of cool this weekend, I'm here to tell you that I think in heaven it's going to be a whole lot better, looking back on the days in which God will lead us and God will bring opportunities for us. So I just set that before you. In the 1800s, there was a man under the name of Thomas Chisholm. Thomas Chisholm lived either in Kentucky or Tennessee. Thomas Chisholm grew up as an uneducated man. He was poor. But in his heart, God placed the desire to be a minister. And somehow or other, God orchestrated that in the days to come, Thomas Chisholm became a minister. And he launched into the ministry with fervor. He lasted 1 year. Not because he didn't love the Lord anymore, but his body wouldn't take the rigors of being a pastor. He couldn't continue to function under the pressure that was his and the responsibilities. And so he went into the insurance business. In all candor, I didn't even know they had insurance people back there. Of course, I wasn't there, but I was a little bit shocked when I read that. But at any rate, he wrote these words, and that's what I want to get to. Even though he couldn't be in the ministry as he wanted, here's what he said. "I must never fail to record the faithfulness of a covenant-keeping God. I must never fail to record the faithfulness of a covenant-keeping God." Well, he kept that because Thomas Chisholm wrote about 1,200 poems and about a couple hundred songs, I believe it was. And one of the songs is the song that we just sang together. "Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. O God, my Father, there's no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. Your compassions, they fail not. As you have been forever, you will be. So great is your faithfulness, great is your faithfulness. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me." And so today, as we embrace God's faithfulness and thank him for it, remembering the past, remembering the present, remembering the future, remembering that God blessed this particular group which we are thinking about today, and God has continued to set forth his gospel message to each and every person who will receive it. We rejoice in the camaraderie of the saints. I like that. We move forward in the strength of God to the task that is before us. The Navy SEALs, well, all branches of the Army and all the groups of the armed forces, almost all of them have mottos. I happen to like stuff like that. So I was reading about the motto of the SEALs. They actually have a couple of them. One of them is "No Man Left Behind." That's the one we kind of know. But there's another one. "It's too good to mess up," so I copied it. "The mission is not complete until the last man gets home." Man, I read that, and I thought, that ought to be the mission of the church. The mission is not complete until the last man comes to a living faith in Jesus. I want to have that as my motive, my motto, that we just do that. And whether we are milking cows or pounding nails or teaching a class or selling insurance or whatever we are doing, that somehow or other that is molded into the ultimate motto of life, and the ultimate motto of life as it plays with the scriptural mandate. Our mission is not complete until the last man gets home. Until the Lord returns, or until the blood quits coursing through my veins and I'm laid to rest. My mission will not be complete. Your mission will not be complete. The mission of the bad acts will not be complete. The mission of the Christian church will go on until Jesus Christ returns and brings us to himself. I think it translates so well. When I come back for your 175th, I want to see that emblazoned on the wall. So, that might not happen. Either of them. But until that day. A shout. A trumpet note. A glorious presence in the azure sky. A gasp, a thrill of joy, and we are with him in the twinkling of an eye. A glance, an upward look. Caught up to be with Christ forevermore. The dead alive, the living glorified, fulfilled are all his promises that came before. His face, his joy supreme. Our souls find rapture only in his feet, at his feet. Blameless, without a spot, we enter into heaven's joy complete. Strike harps, oh, sound his praise. We know him as we never knew before. God's love, God's matchless love, will take eternity to tell while we adore. To that end, we commend you to God. We thank him for the past. We live for him and his strength and grace in the present. We commit ourselves to the task at hand for the future. Please bow. So, Lord, finish then thy new creation. How pure and spotless let us be. Let us see thy great salvation perfectly restored in thee. May we be changed from glory into glory till in heaven we take our place. Till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise. Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Soli Deo Gloria, to God alone be glory. Amen.
For that day. Thank you, Pastor Quam. Let's turn to number 340. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Let's stand and sing. Closing prayer this afternoon, I'd just like to read it from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20 and 21. Now the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. As our benediction today, let's sing together. Number 135. Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love.